Good afternoon. We're going to get the program started. I know we're still waiting for some people, but I'll just kind of get the program kicked off. On behalf of Asia Society Hong Kong Center, it's a great pleasure to welcome all of you here for this first of many events this exciting week for Art Basel Hong Kong. And we're delighted that Asia Society Hong Kong Center can co-host this Art Basel Conversations Homegrown Talent. And it's been only about a year in the works, but it's happening. So as many of you know, we've only been here, this center, 15 months. And in 15 months, we've done some wonderful programs, over 200 actually. We had to count the other day, and over 60% of them have been in the arts and cultural space. And I know now it's going to be a lot more. I've already warned the staff. There's no breaks between now until the end of the year, only because Hong Kong is such a wonderful place these days with all the happening in the arts and cultural realm, and I know Art Basel has a lot to do with that, and we want to thank them. And as a partner, we look forward to further collaborations in the years to come. And we are, if you have been to our center before, also last week we opened up our fourth exhibition, Light Before Dawn, Chinese Unofficial Art, 1974 to 85. And between now and September 1st, I know there's a lot going on this week. If you you don't have time, it's okay. From now until September 1st, come back and see the exhibition. And also, this week we'll be doing a lot of programs. I know you, those of you who get newsletters and email, you will know that we have programs almost every day next week, and almost from now until June. So please come back and join us. And this current show is our second exhibition. Those of you who are with us, we have 12 Hong Kong designer working with Create Hong Kong. Currently, these shows features Chinese mainland artists, and then the next exhibition we're working on with Guggenheim, No Country, will look at contemporary art of South and Southeast Asia. I really don't want to, this is a very short speech. Like Art Basel, our roots really were outside of Hong Kong. Asia Society in New York was founded in 1956 in New York. But since 1990, we've been here. We've been part of the Hong Kong community. So we're very proud of the fact that we are now a vital part of Hong Kong's growing arts and cultural development, like M+ and West Kowloon. As some of you might know, we're located in a historical site that used to be how the store Explosives that was built by the British 150 years ago. 150 years later, this place is still exploding with ideas and creativity. And with that, I would like to invite the man who has helped to lit the spark of Art Basel, Magnus Renfeldt, Director of Asia for Art Basel, to come up. So thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Alice, for your kind words, and indeed for the Asia Society's kind hospitality today. I'd like to welcome you all to the very first Art Basel Conversations in Hong Kong. It's a historic moment for us, and we're very excited about what the week ahead brings. I'd like to thank Absolut Art Bureau, the presenting partner for Art Basel Conversations, for their support in helping to make this happen. And I'd like to introduce Mark Spiegler, the director of Art Basel, just to introduce Art Basel Conversations. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. Thank you for giving up your Sunday afternoon at the beginning of what will be a very long and intense week. But I think it'll be worth it, because as Magnus said, it is a historic moment. This is the first official event of Art Basel in Hong Kong. And I think it's fitting that this first event of Art Basel in Hong Kong should be an Art Basel Conversations, because for the last 10 years, Art Basel Conversations has been one of the things that really made Art Basel distinctive. It's the density of content, the density of panels and talks, and the fact that all of them are available online has meant that Art Basel is more than just an art fair. It's also a place where ideas are exchanged and discussed and debated, and where people walk away not only with objects but also with inspiration. So I hope that this will be an inspiring afternoon for you. You know, I think it's worth noting that this is not, that the Art Basel conversations will not only be freestanding, but in this case, they will be part of the ongoing program of talks and panels that existed before. I think this is one of the great things that we discovered when we came here, was to see that already here you had Asia Art Archive, which is continuing its Unpacking Global series, and Intelligence Squared with its debates, so that we will have, I think, when you add it all together, perhaps the most dense program of talks and panels of any Art Basel fair. So I think that's going to be a great thing for Hong Kong. I think it's also worth noting that this is not the first time that Art Basel Conversations takes place outside of the fair halls, nor is it the first time that Art Basel Conversations takes place in Asia. Because in 2006, Art Basel Conversations took place in Beijing. And the person who was behind that conversation, the person who organized it, was Jonathan Napack. Now, many of you know who Jonathan was. Some of you may not. Jonathan was an American-born journalist who moved very early, before anyone else really understood what was happening in Asia, to Asia. He was an advocate of the Asian scenes. He knew the scenes in Asia. He knew the players and the artists and the curators and the gallerists like the back of his hand. And he was the one who was the first person who was actually asked by Art Basel to study what was going on in Asia, with the idea of eventually coming here and doing a fair. And as a resident of Hong Kong, he was always the one who was arguing very, very strongly that we should bring it here. So in the end, he proved to be right. Unfortunately, he wasn't here. He isn't here because shortly after this Art Basel Conversations, he died a very young death. And Phil Tenari, who was a close friend of his, will give some reminiscences about Jonathan Napack before we start this, because we really thought that given the history, given Jonathan Napack's history, given the fact that he was always a great supporter of Hong Kong and of Asia's artists, it was appropriate that we hold this panel in his memory. So Phil, please share with us.
Thanks. Thanks, Mark. It's an honor to be here and to open on this somber but ultimately also joyous note. I first met Jonathan Napack, and I'm phone as teleprompter, not email. I first met Jonathan Napack in March of 2003. He'd come to Beijing from Hong Kong, where he had moved in 1997 from New York, to speak on a panel that accompanied the opening of an exhibition called Chinese Maximalism, which was curated by Gao Ming Lu at the China Millennium Monument Museum. The panel was about Chinese art and its future, and a number of austere curators made their comments, and then things rolled around to Jonathan. And the subject had shifted to the 1999 Venice Biennale, which included about 20 Chinese artists and is seen internationally, or was at the time, as really a kind of coming out party for the Chinese scene. And Jonathan sort of just opened his mouth and made this comment like, well, everybody knows that this was really just a ploy by the curator Harold Zeman at the end of his career to kind of seem relevant and novel again, which was a typically Jonathan remark laced with references. And for a kid who was fresh out of college, which was me then, and didn't even know who Harold Zeman was, of course, he was the great late Swiss curator, I decided immediately that I needed to become friends with this guy, because you simply didn't see people like this in Beijing very often back then. Jonathan roamed Asia with confidence and cosmopolitanism, passing out his silver Art Basel Advisor Asia name cards through the most obscure reaches of the continent, and coming back to his apartment on Kao Fong to distill the information he had collected into articles for the IHT and dispatches to send back to the Messeplatz. He had come from a legendary journalistic background, spending time in the early 90s in the cohort around a magazine called Spy that was launched by Graydon Carter and didn't actually last very long, writing major investigative pieces on things like the fame of the artist Mel Bochner or the dealings of the Wildenstein family. After a few years of that, he actually got bored and decided to move not where the action was, but where it one day might be. And he came to Hong Kong in 1997. One of Jonathan's most beloved lines was not his own, but Woody Allen's. He believed ardently that 95% of life is showing up. And he spent countless hours on Cathay Pacific jetliners to prove that. He reveled in calculations like how many hours one would need for a proper overnight at the best ryokan in Niigata Prefecture, or what time one might clear customs and emerge onto the streets of Taipei and at a dinner if one took, say, the 5 o'clock flight from Cheplapkok to Songshan. His conversational repertoire jumped flawlessly from Korean party politics to Viennese modernism, from the intricacies of state formation on the Arabian Peninsula to ethnic groups in Malaysia. He could converse with cab drivers in at least 10 languages. Jonathan's worldliness was also effortless, his bright blue Samsonite carry-on always elegantly rolling a step behind him. His entire life that he created for himself in Asia might be summarized by his Chinese name, which was actually Jianglosan, which of course means parachute. When I decided to permanently settle in Beijing in 2006, one of the first orders of business was to work with him on putting together a delegation of Chinese collectors who were being invited to come to Basel at Art Basel's expense to see the fair. And actually, it was a really difficult project, kind of going around Beijing and explaining to people what this Art Basel thing was and why they should give up a week of their time to come and be treated like royalty. That actually doesn't happen anymore. People come on their own. Thank you very much. We also then, as Mark referred to, spent the rest of the summer organizing this edition of Art Basel Conversations, which famously featured Ai Weiwei sitting in the lobby of the National Art Museum of China side by side with Fan Dian and other people from high ranks in the Chinese government, which is another thing that doesn't happen anymore. During that summer of 2006, I actually spent a lot of time here in Hong Kong. I was writing essays for Sotheby's, of all places, anonymously. And hanging out with Jonathan was a near nightly occurrence. Among our most frequent topics of conversation was the one that he dreamed about most, and that was the establishment of a real art world center of gravity somewhere in Asia. And for him, Asia always meant Hong Kong. The last time I saw him was over bagels on Collins Avenue, the Monday after Art Basel Miami Beach in 2006. We had another variation of this same recurring conversation about the future of art in Asia and went off to catch our planes. After he passed away the following month, I picked up quite a number of his duties from freelance assignments that were actually already in progress to his reportage to Art Basel, in fact, and did that job for 5 more years. And it's amazing to think that he did not even actually lived to see the first edition of Art Hong Kong in 2008. More amazing that the fair's meteoric growth followed by its full incorporation into the Art Basel brand, which is of course something we're celebrating this week, played out more or less exactly according to Jonathan's grand plan. And so even if he's not able ultimately to participate in today's proceedings, his legacy certainly lingers. And if you happen to find yourself on Kaofeng, in the western reaches of Central, as you walk up these terraced staircases, you might notice to your right, there's one window on a second floor apartment that looks a little bit different from all of the others. And it's actually surrounded by this custom-made chrome curvy frame that he had custom produced in Shenzhen with one single pane of glass. And there's a light attached to the outside of the building, and he had a switch at his writing desk, and he could turn on the spotlight and illuminate this tree that was just there in public space, but that he kind of looked at as he sat and put together his reminiscences. So I think it's a nice metaphor for a way in which he's been gone for so long, and yet it's easy to almost forget exactly how profound his influence has been. So thank you. And, sorry, am I doing this? Okay, it's my pleasure to introduce my great friend and former Beijing fellow traveler who's now decamped, Pauline Yao.
Thank you, Phil. Okay. Thank you, Phil, and I wanted to thank everybody for being here on a lovely Sunday afternoon. I have a few comments that I'm going to start off with first, and then I'll introduce our artists, and then we'll have a brief discussion I wanted to first thank Mark Spiegler and Magnus Renfrew for inviting me to do this, to moderate this panel, and also to Claudio for his coordination and advice and support in developing this topic and set of ideas that hopefully we can have time to touch on today. And also wanted to thank our panelists for being here. My name is Pauline Yao. I'm a curator at M+, which is the new museum for visual culture in the West Kowloon Cultural District. And I'm joined here on my right, Zhou Junfei, Linda Lai, Ho Sin Tung, and Adrian Wong. I'm going to have a few comments here, and then I'll kind of introduce, and we have like one or two slides just to give you a bit of background on their work. And forgive me while I have to read. the topic for today, title of this panel, is Homegrown Talent. And in thinking about this, I think it's often said that there's an absence of a value attached to specific places and locales in contemporary cultural life. And this might be especially true in the art world, which is often viewed as global and increasingly virtual or even placeless. The debut of Art Basel in Hong Kong, the reason why all of us are here today, is but one example of the global reach of today's art world. And yet I have to think that Art Basel Hong Kong forces a confrontation with its locale in ways that differs from Art Basel Miami, perhaps, or even Art Basel Basel. Perhaps this stems from an appreciation of difference and a desire to have a more nuanced understanding of the context here, and as well to recognize that Hong Kong has its own legacy of artistic production that's maybe different than in those other locales. I might also have to do with what I sometimes refer to, or what I thought about when I prepared notes for this, was Hong Kong's like a topophilia, sort of strong sense of place or love for a certain kind of place, which overwhelmingly becomes mixed with a sense of cultural identity. So even if we admit that generally the power of place is increasingly diminished and occasionally lost, here it certainly thrives with implications that are quite complex. You know, it has often been termed a space of transit that has become a permanent home for many. So I come to this topic of homegrown talent and its subtext of locality and specificity with two kind of perspectives and interpretations. And the first relates to the individual, the homegrown talent, meaning the person, the producer in this case, or you know, artist, is someone being deemed as homegrown owing to the nature of their upbringing or their own background. And then the other might be homegrown in terms of a process by which something is born of a certain place, and you know, something is deemed homegrown owing to the space in which it's produced or the place in which something is produced. In this case, we're talking about art and artworks most of the time. So my interest is really to try to focus on the latter of these two. In other words, to look at this interpretation of homegrown, not only to focus on the identity of the individual makers, but to look at the nature of how things are made or produced here and within the space of Hong Kong. And just a few notes, sorry, bear with me, get us thinking about this notion of place in a general kind of way. Place is both temporal and spatial, personal and political, and comes layered with histories and memories that run wide and deep. It is about connections, what surrounds it, what forms it, what happened there, and what will happen there. The artists gathered here today in various ways demonstrate this, or can be said to demonstrate this sort of pull of place and an urge or need to belong somewhere. Their work is certainly grounded in this particular space. And in the sense, the place is defined by memory, but yet the degree to which the past is key to the present is also something debatable. Indeed, too much emphasis on the past can run a risk of being dangerous, as it may foster a sort of determinism that may limit an openness towards future possibilities. In all discussions of place, it is a question of abstraction and specifics. If art is defined as universal, or in notions where form is valued over content, then artists might be encouraged to transcend their locales or shed their kind of locality. But if we look at it as content being considered a sort of prime component of art and that lived experience is seen as a prime material, then certainly this notion of regionalism or localism is something that wouldn't be seen as a limitation, but something as an advantage. So what I wanted to do today is to explore the ways in which ideas that originate in this place are materialized in this place, and to what extent these artists and others evaluate aspects of their working practice, their chosen medium, their relationship to materials, and eventually and ultimately by extension their roles as artists in this place. So maybe I'll quickly just introduce, and then I'll have a question that I'll pose here. Excuse me, I'm juggling things with many hands here. Okay. Sitting on my right is Zhou Junfei, who is a fine arts graduate from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. I know that a lot of you are probably already familiar with many of these artists, but for those of you that are not, Zhou is an active member of the Fotanian Art Village, visiting lecturer at several different universities, and is most well-known for his paintings of street scenes and, in particular, film stills, which are borrowed from Hong Kong films, which is what you can see here on the screen. Zhou Junfei has also been involved in a variety of projects, one of which being Painting On and On, which is kind of an artist-initiated project looking at the involving local artists in exploring different themes in painting and in organizing group exhibitions, and includes seminars and publications, and has also notably run for office in the LegCo in the position of, I have the sports, performing arts, culture, and publication functional constituency. I know that's a really long name. It might not be the right one. Sitting in the middle, here we have Linda Lai. Sorry, I have my notes here. Linda has a PhD in cinema studies from NYU and is now a professor in the School of Creative Media, is historian, transdisciplinary artist, and her experimental videos and digital and non-digital installations are often borrowing from found footage and involving sort of notions of historiography, autoethnography, urban studies, and archiving. So you can just see some images here. Ho Sin Tung, born here in Hong Kong, is also a graduate from the Chinese University Fine Arts Department. Her work consists predominantly of drawings, including with pencil, graphite, watercolor, using found and ready-made images, maps, charts, and timelines, and involve a kind of combination of imagined and real places that narrates specific stories, some of them personal, and mapping of subjective histories. And Adrian Wong Adrian, born in Chicago and graduate from Stanford University, and also studied sculpture in Yale University, is known for installations and sculptures and videos that uncover lost or hidden histories and examine the divide between reality and myth. Interested in modes of narrative and storytelling, Wong's background draws him to continually perform acts of excavation, narration, and flirtations with the unknown. These are two images of various different installations, and he'll be hosting the Wundun Bar during this week of the fair. So, my question that I'm going to start off by, now that I've said enough, I had individual conversations with all the artists about this sort of this topic and this general general approach, which is to sort of look at artistic practices and working methods. So I wanted to ask each of you to say something about, to reflect upon or say something about the working methods that you think define your practice and how, I mean, obviously how these things might relate to where you live, but I mean, in particular, is your practice studio based, non-studio based? Are you working independently alone? Do you work with others, and in what kind of way? Is there fabrication or outsourcing involved? And how do you, can you reflect in some way on factors of place and how that factors into your work? Maybe we'll start with Zhou Junfei and then, yeah.
Okay. Let me use only 4 minutes to tell you 4 stories. Oh, it's my story, so. I think telling a story is easier to open the dialogue. The first story is I was a taxi driver. I think this is something very local, and it matched the topic today, that I'm a homegrown, maybe a talent, I don't know. But that was a very good experience for me. Of course, for it, at that time, when I owned the taxi, I didn't expect that I would have this kind of experience in my own artwork or in my own creation of work. But if you know, the owning a license, a taxi license in Hong Kong is crazy. Today, if you buy a taxi license, it's around 7 million Hong Kong dollars, which I think this experience teach me a lot about how to run the business, and also how to communicate with all the taxi driver, and how to face the reality of the city, or even how to make a living. So this is the first story. The second story is I come from factories that I own studio in Fulton, which is industrial area in the New Territories. I think this is quite significant for me, or even for the Hong Kong art scene, that you can tell from the Hong Kong local art history that in the 1990s that not many artists in Hong Kong have their studio. Then all you can see in the art scene is installation, performance. Well, you don't have the space to produce the work, so you have to install the thing at the venue, and then you just throw all the things away after the show. But starting from us, I would say, of course, before us, there were artists in factory, but maybe we are the group which is loud enough to organize some kind of event like Open Studio, and then even the general public recognize us as the Fultanian, because we are in Fulton. We add IAN at the end of Fulton, so we call ourselves Fultanian as a group of artists working in factories. The third story is I was said to be the first generation, but I'm not really agree, but I was said to be the first generation who can be a full-time artist in Hong Kong. Well, that's horrible because I just read, I just watched the video interview I did just 7 years ago, and we were still in a debate that what if an artist who are not full-time, is he or she is a professional artist, but well, I think right now we don't have this kind of debate that if you have to be professional, then you have to be full-time artist. I don't think this is a very good measure to count who is an artist. But I want to tell this story just because, well, the art fair is coming, so artists working with the galleries now to become a common phenomenon in Hong Kong. But I just try to tell you that when I graduate, I did an oil painting in my graduation show, and some of my friends wrote in the wrote to me that please don't give up painting. But I don't. I think just because at that time not many Hong Kong artists worked with galleries at that moment. But now fresh graduates are blamed to be too commercial, or they try to get into galleries with too much intention. The fourth story. I ran the election of the Legislative Council last year. Well, I don't want to talk too much about the politics in today's talk, but I think this is also something happening in Hong Kong that not only for the artists, but as the general public, they are more concerned about the local politics. And when I ran the election, I gave up all my work last year. I spent the whole year running the election, which I know I must lose. And I didn't declare that that was an art piece, because if I declare that that was some kind of performance, then all the audience will just watch the performance and don't treat it as a serious election. But for me, it's also a very, I would say, local experience, because when you talk about politics, then it has to be local, and it may also relate to today's talk too.
Can my voice be heard? I have a very terrible voice today, I'm sorry. And just something in my mouth is helping to sweeten the voice a little bit, not so horrible. Actually, I also have a few stories, but maybe I can tell them as one. I feel very flattered to be invited here, because in fact, I think considering the advancement into art, I think I'm relatively young, even though I'm the oldest on the panel. I consider myself self-consciously thinking myself as an artist for about 13 years only. The first little story has to be very short, but I felt I have to say it. I think I am a very typical homegrown Hong Kong person, and I'm typical in the sense that those typical things that all the Hong Kong kids who might have an art flair would do, I have done all of them. So when I was a kid, I joined a studio and I learned painting, everything, and would do a teacher-student exhibition. I joined a choir, I got trained in music, I was much into theater when I was an undergraduate student. And everything stopped. In fact, one semester of the two semesters of oil painting really put me off, and I decided that I have to quit painting. It was done at Chinese U. I was minor in fine arts. and something else took me away from theater, and I was into body work and pantomime and experimental theater. So there was that's the end of the story. But I want to say that this is a typical story of any Hong Kong kids who show potentials in art. They would have done all of the above that I just mentioned. I also want to let this off, because I think there's a strong critique in what I said, how people are being developed as artists in Hong Kong, and where do we find kids who really got a chance to have a better way to identify their artistic talents. But okay, period. There's a 20-year gap between those days when I was heavily trained in the various medium and when I became very self-consciously working on artworks that I felt, as an artist, self-consciously. But I felt these 20 years of gap extremely productive because that's what exactly made me do what I'm doing now. During those 20 years, I was a journalist. I worked for Albert Chen. I wrote stories about the stock market. I interviewed a lot of the tycoons, including Lei Kwok Po and all those people, and they were very happy about the story I wrote for them. I was a secondary school teacher, absolutely defeated about how incapable of, you know, helping students to stay calm in classroom. Then I became very religious at one point, and I was the magazine editor for secondary school publication, et cetera, et cetera. Until all the way through, I felt there's always one thing at the back of my mind that I wish I could do, but I never got the chance nor the money to do it, which is to make a movie. So chance came. I was accepted to the PhD program at NYU. So I thought, PhD program is not filmmaking, but would I go? Of course I would. And in between, I also did another degree in the US in journalism. So I felt I was actually very good at, you know, theoretical stuff. So I felt, okay, I will do it. At NYU, I also got small opportunities to become a filmmaker. Again, because I didn't have the money to get all the equipment, all the resources, I didn't do it. So that was how I spent my 20 years until I arrived at the School of Creative Media, where I started teaching. And something happened. I went there, I think I was hired because they want me to teach creative writing. So I did creative writing. Immediately, all the connections with all these other things that I had experienced came back. I am a true believer in surrealist automatism. So that was how I conducted my creative writing class. And because I was there, I met other artists, and these artists introduced me to other artists because I love books. So one day I talked to a photography friend, a colleague, can we make a book together? So we started photo text dialogue. And it so happened that Parasite had an exhibition called Social Club, and I was invited. I don't know why, but I was invited. So it was like that. And then later on, I became Parasite's board member. I met more and more artists. I had to critique my students' work day and night, and I became very, very frustrated with the way they work. And suddenly I felt, it seems I have all the ideas and the principles and everything that I had to make them an artist, and I'm not making anything. So I thought maybe I should start making something. And definitely the first thought that came to my mind was to make a movie, because that's where I started this long journey away from art and also back to art. Something stuck in my mind, and very personal obsession, and I felt personal obsessions are good because they took me somewhere. I wanted to do something about my grandmother. So I started to plan the video work on her. It never got done up to this very point. I made a lot of videos, but never made one about my grandmother. When I started to look at what to make, I discovered something, because I was always carrying a camera all these years. So when I started to think of making something in about 2002, I had already 10 years of video footage with me. Video diaries that were made with or without any purpose, most of the time without any purpose. So I started to look at them as a stranger. Wonderful things came up. I felt I'm studying another person's life. So very quickly, I just want to say that was how I actually, on the one hand, after the 20 years gap, I got a lot of good opportunities, chance, luck. I get connected to the art world and started good conversations. And thanks to this communal aspect, But on the other hand, I was only just very quietly working, making my own videos, many of them. And then one day I started to send them to one festival, just one, a famous one in Germany. And then they got it, they accepted it, and they invited me. So after that, I just promised myself I would make a move, I will make a video, at least one video once a year. And I've been doing that. So I got a lot of works just because I felt, you know, there's a lot of resources back home. I think the general model that I've been adopting so far is I never worry about not having a work. If anyone comes to me and say, Linda, can you make a work? I would definitely say yes, even though I don't have the answer. Because I don't work with a studio model. I work with a model that is collecting things. I'm like a gleaner of my own images in everyday life, gleaner of found footage. I love Hong Kong movies, although they are banal, disgusting, you know, sometimes really horrible, but I love looking at them. I love just any movies. And because of the bad situation in Hong Kong, very young, I was driven to love cinema from all over the world. So I have a lot of things at hand. So as a gleaner, that was how I started to work. So I would always go back to my own gleaner's collection and pick up things. The latest work, finally, is a big installation in Shanghai Biennale. It was the only work that is not video as its own, as its main medium. But I was so happy that there was a chance when I can combine my role as a cultural historian, as a film studies person, also as a gleaner, as an ethnographer, and bring everything together. And suddenly there was a story about my grandmother, which is actually about the Cultural Revolution. So, I mean, I hope this portrayed the kind of ecology that I wanted to, you know, suggest that it's very strange what is homegrown and what is not homegrown, and how to respond to what you have and, you know, pick up piece. And I think when I don't try very hard to be a good artist, I became a better artist.
Thank you.
Hey, and I want to begin with how I start painting at the first place. I was 3 years old, and I just decided to learn painting as a, you know, all the small kid went to the, you know, painting class in the neighborhood. And just downstairs from my house, there was a painting studio organized by Gaylord Chen, who is a quite established painter in Hong Kong. But of course, my parents and I didn't know, but we sort of like, is the closest painting studio to my house. So I went there to learn painting, and they offered me with a quite different education from the Hong Kong art education, because when I was very small, they already gave me a big canvas to work on, and they didn't give you any specific topics. And since you were small, you have to think of what do you want to say and what are you trying to do with your own little space and your own little world. But at the same time, I'm very well-trained kind of Hong Kong student. I did quite good in exams, and I like doing all the papers. I like lessons. And you usually heard a lot of people complaining about the education system. They say, oh, they can't concentrate in class. But actually, I'm quite the opposite. I enjoy going to school. I love taking exams, actually. I think it's a very exciting process, you know, sitting there and do your own work, and I love exams. So I think it's sort of refused in my work too, because as Pauline introduced, my work is a lot of times about maps and charts, and all in all it's about some existing formats of pictures and how you archive something. And my work is sort of like filling in the blanks, because there was a photo of my work, which is a fake film festival I did last year. I designed 28 fictional movies written by myself and organized them into a film festival, which involves film posters and film stills, synopsis, trailers, video. And because to me, film festival is a sort of existing format that contains a lot of information, and therefore, at the opposite, it is a lot of empty space that you can fill in different information to make it look organized, because in my mind it's always very messy. I'm not a very organized person, so I need a format to help me to organize a narrative and the storytelling part. And I want to say just a few second things about how Hong Kong is, because I never consider myself anything Hong Kong. So when Pauline invited me to do the talk, I was a little bit embarrassed by the topic, because I never have any intention to put Hong Kong in as a subject of my work. But of course, a lot of writers and art critics think that my work is very Hong Kong in a way. I make Hong Kong Film Festival, Hong Kong maps, and Hong Kong seating plan of cinemas. But I think as an artist, I just capture something strong to me. You know, some strong experience and something strong I encounter, or something so tiny that it becomes strong to me and then I want to capture it. And of course, a daily personal life of a person will always seem strong to you. And then because I happen to be born in Hong Kong and then I do things like that, but I never consider myself anything Hong Kong, because many of my references are Western literature and Western movies. And since I was small, I keep losing weight during the Lunar New Year because I hate Chinese food and I just like Western food since I was a small kid. So even my parents keep saying I'll marry a foreigner since I was a small girl. So I never considered myself anything typical Hong Kong, but there is a thing about me is that when I was around 10 years old, my family moved to Changshou, which is the northest part of Hong Kong, which is very, very close to China. I still live there now, except sometimes I live in my studio as well. And if I take a taxi from my home to China, the taxi fee would just stay the same. It's that close. And then, so I have a very isolated environment and my house is far away from everything in Hong Kong. Going back to China is even closer for me to go to a place like Mong Kok or here. If from my house, I think I have to spend like 2 hours coming here. So I have, since I was at school, I have to travel a lot every day from home to school. So I have a complete isolated period. So I use that time to read and think about a lot of things. I think that one of the things that makes me become quite maybe different people in school, because you have some time to contemplate about things in the journey back and forth every day. And living in Changshou is a very interesting experience as well, because you know, a lot of mainland people are coming to Hong Kong. And even before all the debates going on in the news recently, this experience actually got into me and my family pretty early, even when I was in primary school and secondary school. You have a strong feeling that your home, the things around you will keep changing, not according to your needs, but according to other people's needs, the mainland tourists, and a lot of urban planning stuff. And then you have a strong feeling that the place you were in, the place you have memory in, is keep disappearing. Even my primary school is demolished by the government, so you have a fear of losing your own language and fear of losing your memory and place. That's one of the reasons I start doing maps at the first place. And I think it's too long, so.
Thank you. Adrian.
I'm going to be very brief. I'm not from here. I grew up in Chicago. I came here on vacation in 2005. And I've been here for 8 years. In terms of studio practice, I was here on a planned 3-month vacation. I got stir crazy, started looking around for spaces where I could work. And this is a much longer story that I'm not even gonna tell. I found a haunted studio at 50% off and signed a 2-year lease, thinking that I could just walk away and have some place to work. The first thing that really caused me to fall in love with Hong Kong is inexpensive wood. You could get 4 2x4s for the price of one, and here they're planed and jointed, so they're actually 2 inches by 4 inches, and they don't segregate by species. So I was really kind of in hog heaven. I came from outside of New York, where, you know, with a lot of the restrictions on growing lumber, costs were really escalating, and as a sculptor that works quite large, one of the biggest draws, and I'm sorry to be so callous and kind of on the bottom here, but I was here initially because of a nice studio and inexpensive wood. As I started kind of building my practice, I was able to realize things that I just really couldn't do in the United States. And I'm quite transient. I travel quite a lot. I teach in the United States. I'm a collateral faculty at UCLA. I just finished a term in Richmond, Virginia. But I keep coming back because as I started building things, I started to necessarily kind of start to glean bits of the culture. I am ethnically Chinese. My mother and father were both born in Hong Kong, but were both to different extents estranged from their families. And so I used that as an excuse to kind of dig into my own genealogy to kind of really absorb a culture that I had no real access to. You know, growing up in the Midwest, I was in a town of 20,000 people, and I think six of them were Asian. It was me, my mom, my dad, my sister, my grandmother, and it was my dentist, Dr. Feldman's daughter, was adopted from Cambodia. In terms of identity, I consider Hong Kong my home. I am fascinated by the place, but it's not, I don't entertain any sort of fantasy that this is who I am. I love the city to death. I guess I don't want to go on too much. It allowed me to kind of get into the expansive potential offered by fabrication. And I'm not just saying this as a turn of phrase, I love my contractor. Richie Wong is an absolute genius. He's got a fantastic team of people around him, the best artisans I've ever seen in the whole world. And we're a family, you know. I'm able to kind of generate ideas with him and get to places that I couldn't get to before. I've worked with some amazing choreographers. I also love my choreographer and stage director that I've worked with, Lorea Silabarrieta. There's just my assistant Roy is. It's like the child I never had I would have had to have been 8 years old when I had him, so it's a physical impossibility, but you know, he's like the son I never had, and he's come into his own, set up his own fabrication shop. It's really, for me, it's a really kind of wonderful place where, you know, minds can meet and we can figure things out together. You know, my other studio assistant is a rabbit who lives in my shop and choose things that I paint with carrot juice. Really, Hong Kong was a place where I was able to learn about different ways of making, to just kind of relish in the plethora of materials that are available, and also to use it as a jumping off point for my own kind of discovery of the city. And it's really kind of mysterious and largely untapped history. So that's my take.
Thanks, Adrian. Adrian and I actually grew up both in Chicago.
We grew up very close together.
While we're confessing things, I'm not from here either. One thing I wanted to follow up on and kind of pose another area to discuss is this issue. I mean, Adrian, you mentioned it very very practically, is you know, the materials, right, and access to things. But also, this comes out of, as you said, as you being trained as a sculptor. And I realized in putting together this group of people here, we have you know, Adrian, who works primarily in sculpture, Ho Sin Tung primarily doing drawing, I could say, two-dimensional. Predominantly, Linda, predominantly working, in video, and Judge and I predominantly working in painting. So we have a kind of representation of all these different media here. But at the same time, almost all of you have not only done things that are outside that comfort zone, but in some cases, almost like combined and sort of worked across media, or the particular media that you're working in is something that also is almost embedded within another. So, you know, Zhou Zhenfei, I think of your paintings, and I think of how that relationship, particularly the film stills, is so embedded again with with film, and even Adrian, in some of your performances or some of your sculptural work involves a kind of theatrical, choreographical, performative part. So there's a kind of crossing over and a kind of I mean, I would say intermedia maybe, but not so much in the sense of being new media as much as it is crossing kind of these disciplines or areas. I don't know if I should pose this question to one of you or if someone wants to answer this directly, but you know, how have you gotten settled on the particular media that you work in? And when you're coming up with certain concepts, ideas, what is the chosen sort of avenue for that sort of manifestation? Is there any particular, anyone you want to comment?
I mean, I was originally trained as a social scientist, so I left a psychology program to become a sculptor. And so there's still that little monster in my head that's really fascinated by the things that I interact with on a daily basis. And it's a real luxury not to have a regular job. So by wandering around, I get fixated on different things. The initial outlet for a lot of my own projects has been theater. But as I progressed, I started to become more interested in reality. For example, in this project that hopefully you guys will join us at after this talk, the bar that I'm producing for the Absolut Art Bureau under the Fringe Club, we had initially kind of staged the entire thing as a theatrical production. So we were looking for professional actors and professional singers to portray these characters that I find to be emblematic of the city and these idiosyncratic people that you pass on a daily basis. Due to budgetary reasons and difficulty in sort of managing so large of a cast, we kind of had this light bulb went off, and I decided to actually cast those people into the bar as themselves. So now our bathroom attendant is the security guard for my apartment complex. The maitre d' is the captain of the Star Ferry that goes across the harbor. I was looking for an awkward waiter, and we were auditioning and looking at all these tapes, trying to find someone who could play sort of a cross between Buster Keaton and Goofy the dog from the. And this is not to cast aspersions on the person we cast, but we thought, well, we want a goofy waiter. Let's go to some restaurants and find a goofy waiter. So I think a lot of the things about bridging those boundaries is through just kind of allowing myself to entertain these like fixations and to approach these discoveries through the techniques of research that I'd learned in a different field as a psychologist, kind of trying to plumb out the little nugget of interest that I'm stopping at as I just go through my daily life.
Well, for me, I think there are two reasons or two matters affecting my choice of media. The first one is about my training, because I study in Chinese university in Hong Kong. Our training is not like the one in the Central Academy in China, that we learn everything. We learn brush and ink, landscape, and then suddenly 2 hours later we do insulation, and then 2 hours later we do oil painting. So when we pick up the brush, then I always ask myself, why should I pick up the oil as my medium? Well, we can do something else. So it is always a question for artists here, I think, because of our training, that why should we pick up a certain media as our creation of work. The other reason is about space, I would say. Even though I now have my own studio and many artists who are sharing studio in the industrial area, the space is still very limited. Like, actually, at this moment, I'm having a show in Lingnan University. I also include two other artists in the show, because I am the creator of the show too. One of the artists is Ivy Ma, actually, and actually the work is not that studio-based. The work is about highlighting or hiding something on the novel. So it's just a eight pieces of book. And when I tried to collect the work, then she told me that the book is, was in the gallery, so I have to go to the gallery to collect the book, but there's a bookshelf. And the bookshelf is in a friend's studio, so I go to her friend, who's called Alex, when I go to his studio, and then he told me that the upper part of the shelf is at his studio, but the bottom part is somewhere else. So it's, space is always the biggest issue in Hong Kong, not only because of physical size of the space, but also the, well, this is political again that who own the space. Today when I drive here, well, I'm a taxi driver, so I'm so confident that I won't lose my way. But when I park at the shopping mall, when I have to walk through the shopping mall to here, then I lose my way in the shopping mall. And I always have this kind of question, who owned the space when I try to get here? I said that I won't be too political today, but space is something that affects our process of work and also even our own practice. When we have a limited space and we try to solve the problem of space first, so it also affects the use of the media.
I usually use pencil because I think this sort of drawing pencil sort of medium labels is designed for a brief introduction because I consider myself, I always do different mediums, like I also do videos and sometimes installation and drawings, and I also have a column in newspaper. I also write for the newspaper and I work at some freelancers as writing. So I never really use any kind of mediums to set boundaries to myself, but when people have to introduce me or include me in some project, they always need these kind of labels to give the identity to me. And so usually people will conclude that, oh, I usually is a painter who use pencil, but and also at the same time, that's sort of true because I always use pencil as my medium because I think pencil is a very intimate relationship between me and the material. When I use pencil, it feels like you are on a desk, you're writing something. Because my when I first start making artwork, my work is I never consider anything like audience because I only make my work for one person. So it's like the relationship of writing a letter to someone, and all the other audience is sort of bonus or extra to me. So I think the practice of using pencil build up an intimate relationship of me and my work that helps me quite a lot. And
I think I always self-consciously consider myself an intermediate artist, and intermediate is actually a very important principle in my creative work. I guess for the sake of conveniently communicating myself to others, I do want to say that I'm primarily a montage artist because that's what I'm working with, moving image with a collage activity. But I think maybe there are two aspects about my intermediate practice. The test for a work that I make is always where it goes. So some of the works that I like better are those works that happen to be accepted in different places. And there's one example, which is it is accepted as an experimental film work in an experimental film festival. It also was accepted as a documentary in a documentary film festival. The work was also curated by an exhibition on hearing, because the work has a strong musicality in the image work. I mean, this is one aspect how I test whether, okay, am I achieving, am I looking at moving image not just as moving image, but as something that can dialogue with other things. So, sorry. In editing my videos, I often brought in things from other disciplines. things from ethnography, for example, things from generative art, calculation, formalism. I bring in things from just any other discipline that will help me organize something. And this also is, for me, the material exists in front of me. It demands me to look at it in a very, with new light, and it asks me to go out to look for the best possible way to put them together. And so this forms my intermediate impulse. Another way to look at it is when I'm doing something, there's always other things happening on the way that turn the work into more than one. I remember my first time of producing the image, photo image book with my photography friend. We were about to complete the whole book and everything else. But along the way, we actually pulled out a few pieces and sent it to the Hong Kong Art Biennale as a digital piece, just playing with a few images and text and with a lot of mouse interaction. So in fact, that work was first shown before the book was published. And along the way, we also went to Parasite to show a few pieces. So this also is a mold that I have taken, that along the way of making something, molding something, I churn out a lot of byproducts that are equally interesting. And so my artistic principle really is I discover when I make works. So I don't usually have a strong, like, this is the work I want to make, so let me execute it. And that's not my working mold. But I quite enjoy, since I'm rather clear that I have a paradigm with myself, someone who cares about history, who cares about Hong Kong, who often worries about Hong Kong's city look disappearing. So with all this care, concern in my mind, everything actually always comes together. And I find that very, rather, it's surprising even to myself how consistently my concern were, and they turn out works that have very different looks, but actually they are about the same kind of concern. But the last thing I want to say is something really exciting about Hong Kong cinema, even though I think Hong Kong films are not very good in quality in terms of film art. I crazily collect Hong Kong films, and I cut out all these location shots and save them. Because this is how I get a chance to look at Hong Kong in the past and the swift changes that take place every day in the city space and the objects that got disappeared. I think that this is maybe why I became a gleaner. and also become very obsessed with cutting out shots, location shots, and see what I can do with them. I don't know what exactly to do with them yet.
I have such kind of archive too.
We can share.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, I did think there was one thing that I was thinking about all of your different practices and how the various relationships there are to modes of research, or how one might define the kinds of research that's happening that leads into particular work. Sometimes it's more passive in a way, and sometimes it's more active. But I wonder, Adrian, you started off by saying something about your sort of motive, or something about how you were kind of following certain tracks in the research that might.
Yeah.
End up ultimately in a given work, and then it's kind of accidental, or is it kind of how are you formulating that, or how conscious are you in beginning to decide something and then pursue it, or is it more accidental?
I think in the concept development mode, I'm very much I have like notebooks of things that could be potential sites of fascination. So, and they sort of gestate, and sometimes they mash together and evolve into different things. But I don't know if my research is necessarily fully formed from the onset. It tends to kind of come out of a process of partaking in a really ridiculous activity. So it's about diving all the way in. You know, for example, I've gone through periods, and these have not even really been tapped to their full potential. I'm currently doing a lot of work on age regression hypnotherapy and the potential for that to open up different modes of thinking. And so instead of, you know, going to the library, I sort of decided to start cold calling hypnotists. And so I've been periodically going through this process of experientially kind of getting into the effect of what it is to go along with the idea of returning to a younger time and sort of reducing the formal modes of thinking that I've kind of become accustomed to. I am very excited about a lot of the work that I've done. We've only done some cursory projects together, but recently met Thomas Cheng, who's based here in Hong Kong. He's a world-famous animal communicator. So he's been helping to facilitate conversations with myself and cats. Cats so far, I really do hope we can start to do some roundtable discussions. I have two rabbits, like I mentioned before, who I think need a bit of a mediation session. But I think being an artist affords you the opportunity to do these sorts of things. It allows you to kind of suspend disbelief and really just dive in and invest in things that, you know, that the life of an artist allows you time to kind of play around in these areas that I guess are very easy to think about for a second and move on. I like to think about stuff for a second and sit there for a week and see if I want to spend more time there. So I think my research comes from that. I think the structure falls in instinctively through, you know, my training as a social scientist.
But Adrian, last week when I talked to Pauline, that I found out that all of four of us our work based on research. And yes. But when I'm talking about your work, then your research is always doing something which cannot be categorized. Like what animal?
An animal communicator?
Is that something could be done in a research intended to?
Thomas Cheng, he's got a website. You should look this guy up. He's fascinating. I was helping him set up an EKG machine to actually test brainwave patterns on his cats. About a year ago, but no, I mean it's not a subject matter that's often researched, but I think it's something that you can apply research principles to. You know,
research done by alien.
I think research is just a state of mind. Mm. You know, it's about systematically and to a certain extent objectively filtering information. And using that to do justice to your subject matter. I think there's a certain degree of ethics that's associated with this kind of work. And I think maybe that's just residual former scientific thinking sort of stuff. But I do feel like when I dive into a subject matter, I want to be fair. And, you know, I don't even consider myself an expert. And that also relates to my, like, the deep sense of collaboration that my practice takes on. Because, you know, I'm not going to read about the potential for talking to animals and sit down and have coffee with a guy who's dedicated his life to it and either write it off or pretend to be an expert myself. It's about really kind of using these, the massive amount of expertise that these people have kind of dedicated their lives to and trying to inject some of that as content into my work without taking ownership of it. And I think that's why I so fluidly work with other people.
I tend to differentiate different kinds of research in the context of art making, because a lot of times when we talk about research, it's just background information, like I need a figure, a name, or whatever. But I think maybe there's a way to look at research in art, which is to take the research process as the artistic process, whereby discovering new things and in the process keep making new decisions and changes to mold the work is also, you know, what that would be what I call research as art. But I think Adrian's I think your method is very interesting because you are taking something very seriously. You know, it's something that actually belongs to a discipline, and you take it up and you open it and you put it into a very different context. So in a sense, I think this is a very laboratory kind of, you know, there's a laboratory dimension to what you're doing, except it's not for the original purpose of curing or applying therapy, right?
I guess I get that's a good way of doing it. I mean, I am obsessed with things. I think the reason I decided to become a sculptor is because I really, you could make a thing and it's like, it's there in the world now. And I think that's, it sounds so stupid. But I think the idea of bringing a thing into the world was kind of, was like, that was the baby step into kind of integrating with, you know, my intellectual interests are kind of married through sculpture and performance and creating sets and making these, you know, these robot shows. It brought it together. I think all of it is about kind of creating objects that enter into the world as opposed to being, you know, simulations of it or representations of it. They're things in and of themselves. And so I don't know, I guess, you know, my studio is not, you know, it's not like a laboratory. I think it's probably not all that different looking than another studio, but it's really about kind of bringing people together and like not taking for granted that ideas I don't believe float around in the air. I think that they like live in experience and they live in people and their lives, and everything is nuanced and everything is to a certain extent subjective because we're all filters of the things that we see around us. And I think that by bringing these people together and working together earnestly to kind of create new stuff, it's exciting to me to spring forth out of that and to kind of dump things into the world that maybe weren't necessarily coming from a particular category. Yeah. Did the light change in here just now?
It's on.
I think. Did you have another comment? No. Okay.
No. But I just want to add that. What you just said helped me to understand your work more. Because when I just come into the presence of your work, it's always the first immediate response is, that's my response. And I think it's a good response. Because
that sounded like a pretty ambivalent
It's not like, oh, beautiful. I mean, I don't think this is the kind of, I don't know.
You don't think my work is beautiful?
Well, that's not the first word that came to my mind. I often look at it as a, and I felt that, and I gather that maybe it's because of that hybridity, the strangeness, the in-betweenness, that kept me there, even though my response is not, wow, very pleasant or very beautiful, but it kept me there to look at it. Does that make you feel better, if this is the kind of response?
Okay. I'm very happy with that.
If there's no other comments, I think maybe we'll, I think we'll take if there were any comments or questions that someone in the audience might have to share. Anybody? Fun, casual, no pressure. Okay. And when you... And when you're asking your question, please, let us know your name.
Okay, my name is Claudio. First of all, thanks for all these insights. For me, it was really interesting, as I'm from Europe, that things are not too different here. But something you started to mention it that is really important in Europe is that young artists, they start to do collectives, they start to collaborate because it's the notion of together we're much stronger. So it's a lot of artist-run spaces. I wonder if this is also, if there is also a scene here in Hong Kong. And the other thing is that I'm from Switzerland, which is in the middle of Europe, and we get to travel a lot. So in 5 hours we're in Paris, in 10 hours we can go to Berlin, so their young artists are traveling all the time. And I wonder if you do the same, and when you travel, where do you go? Can you go to mainland China a lot? And what are the cities that you have exchanges?
Is your question directed at any particular person?
No.
Who wants to answer? I used to have a studio in Beijing. I rented for 3 years, and then they want to clear out all those artists in 2010, so I moved back to Hong Kong. But I saw the differences too, that when I pump in my friend's studio, sometimes I saw 10 assistants mixing the paints and the other 10 assistants doing the ceramics. While in Hong Kong, you don't have the space and you don't have the assistant to do this kind of work because the cost is much more expensive here. So, but of course, that kind of collaboration is not the one we just mentioned, but like when you have a contractor or when you do some research, you cooperate with a partner rather than just to employ an assistant. So I think that there's two kind of collaboration too. And I did think of this process. It may also affect my creation of work too. So this sort of work that I tried to duplicate a painting, but with a team of assistant or partners, and it turns out to be something like a performance, which I think it is also the process or the starting point, which is the studio or the assistant or the partner, will affect the result of the work, which even though I start with a painting, but it comes out as an performance.
But there's also a sense of community. You know, like my first studio, I was here from 05 to beginning in 2009. We were all together in this factory district. I think Photon has been a really strong part of the art scene here. I think it's allowed people to have, allowed emerging artists, mid-career artists, late-career artists to have space to meet with each other, to casually interact. Fatanian, that happens, is it once a year or twice a year now?
Once.
It's once a year now. But it's an amazing open studio event. It brings the whole city together. And I think that there's certain districts. There's also the Futak building in Wan Chai. There are some very strong communities that are forming, some around even gallery programs. But I do feel that sense that there's that tightness. I think up until recently, Hong Kong has been a place that offered, I'm not casting aspersions on Hong Kong and things are changing, but it's not the kind of place where there's a large enough community and a large enough flow of international artists where it's easy to stay here and remain engaged and excited as an artist that's creating new work and generating things that, you know, need an audience. And so I feel like there's a fair amount of travel. We're always bouncing around. You want to go out for a drink. You have to figure out who's in town in order to, you know, send out your Evite. But I think there's a fair amount of back and forth between here, would you say Singapore, Tokyo, Bangkok, Taipei, obviously Beijing, Shanghai.
I just noticed that in the past few years, most of my students who graduated, these are media art students, they like to form a group. And 50% to make money, get jobs, and then at the same time, they will start writing grant applications to get money to do what they really want to do. So I gather that this might be a trend that would sustain. And they are actually, I'm more on the optimistic side, that in the past 10 years, there are actually more and more young festivals, grants available for them. And so this is, I think in my view, this is actually, in terms of resources, this might be the best time I have seen so far in Hong Kong. My students like me, they like to go overseas. So they are not targeting that much to, showing their works locally. So all the major media art festivals are outside Hong Kong. And to begin with, I think in Asia, Seoul, South Korea, Singapore, Taiwan, these are places that we all want to go.
My name is Jenny Lam. I'm also from Chicago. So the Midwestern presence is strong in this room.
I think you asked a question at the last Art Basel conversation
in
Basel. I did.
We talked last year. And my question is, once again, for you, Adrian. So I'm from Chicago. My parents are from Hong Kong. I love Hong Kong whenever I come here. I love it. But it's also kind of like this weird third cultural kid thing where you're a foreigner, essentially, but you know, you're ethnically Chinese. And I was wondering if, Adrian, you ever come across that kind of, you know, inner, not turmoil, but like these kinds of issues, and if that informs your work.
Oh, to me?
Yes.
Yeah, it's definitely, see, my parents are very Americanized as well. I didn't grow up eating very much Chinese food. I wasn't like embedded into a community. It's a funny story. I had a lot of difficulty when I first came out here because of the scale of my work. I need to work with contractors. I need to work with fabricators quite a bit. And when people thought I was Chinese, I speak Cantonese at maybe like a third grade level. If people know that my last name is Wong and they know that I'm ethnically Chinese, I'm a disgrace to my own culture. People think I'm stupid or there's something wrong with me. People won't, like, I couldn't buy lumber at one place anymore because they were like, we're not going to talk to you. So I came up with this brilliant idea. I dropped the G off of my name card. So I have a fake name card that says Adrian Wan. And I copied a bunch of Korean characters on the back. And so if I tell certain people that I'm Korean and I speak terrible Cantonese, they're like, oh my God, this guy's a genius. So so some people I still work with think that I'm a fake Korean in certain contexts to smooth that boundary. I think that it's helped me more than it's hurt me. I think having a Chinese face opens certain doors. You're able to gain access to certain certain sites, certain kind of certain environments where I feel very lucky to be in between. I think I used to be conflicted, but I think it's really done me more favors than it's hurt me.
Any other questions, comments, observations? No? Don't be shy. Okay, one over here.
Hi, my name is Rupa Dattani. I just wanted to ask you about, you said that there are people who do art at home, not necessarily participate in an exhibition. How do they exhibit art, or how do they get in touch with the other artists? Like, who are not professionally, like a full-timer, like how you mentioned at the beginning of the talk, that you don't have to do it full-time, or just do only art as in art and not do anything else? So how do they get together?
For me, I was a full-time artist because I was unemployed. Well, that was because I graduated. When I graduated, the economy was the worst time of the over the 10 years. So I was unemployed, and then I hid in the factories, and still I managed to survive. But of course, I think the maybe I should answer like if we compare Hong Kong with mainland China, that like we in Hong Kong we still have the choice that we can have many other freelance job. Like when I started, I did a lot of freelance design, and I teach a bit at the very beginning. But if you are in Beijing, as I know, and many of my friends in Beijing, they are not local Beijing. They are from other part of China. So like one of my friends who is from Mongolia, that when he was in his hometown, he just earned maybe several hundred RMB a year by teaching. And then suddenly he became an artist, and he can sell the painting in the price of 100,000. So for them, that's the only choice to make a better living, to be an artist. But I would say if you're in Hong Kong, you have many other way to earn a living. So if you pick up artists as your career, then that is a choice of many other choices, I would say. So, and I always make a joke that if you want to be an artist in Hong Kong, what you have to do is just to pay the rent of a studio. Then you own a space in full time, then you have the open studio and you make shows once a year. But of course, this is the just a joke that if you want to be a so-called professional, then you have many other things to do to make a better work or many other things to do.
Thanks. Oh, you paint a very optimistic picture. Does anybody? I was just thinking earlier how in this part of this panel, I was thinking how, you know, what are the sort of challenges that artists face here, but it seems from your comments you don't you can only though if you can, as long as you can cover the rental costs of your studio, but that itself
it's not, well, that's just how you get your membership card, so yeah. Like then you have to actually, you know,
yeah, I think then you have to perform.
Yeah.
Are there any other comments or questions from the audience? Okay, one more.
Hi, it's Jonathan. Actually, I have a question to the artist. It is about censorship. So, what do you think about this as an issue for your work to be displayed in Hong Kong or China?
Anybody want to tackle that one?
I play with that. I make several works playing with. I always say I'm doing experiment to test about the censorship. Some I just did a work which mentioned about which is about the June 4th incident, the Tiananmen incident, which I was saying for sure I cannot show that work in China. But I just did a test of what would happen in Hong Kong. So I tried to apply that painting in different occasions. It was accepted by a gallery, and it was rejected by the Hong Kong Biennial. And I tried to show it in the university. And then finally, I sold the work to Switzerland. So it has to be out of China. But for me, the work, if in the coming future it could be shown in the mainland, then I would say the work finished in that way. But I also did something like I tried to, when the reporters asked for photo, I tried to send them this painting to the magazine. So. Just the latest issue of City Magazine, they have that painting on the page of 89. I tried to send it to a mainland magazine, but I know there would be a censorship. So I sent them a portrait of mine, and at the back of my own portrait, it is the painting. And the word June 4th is just hide in my back. So the work finally can be shown in the magazine of in mainland, but I would say this is also a censorship by myself too, that I try to hide the word at the back of mine.
I had a painting, usually my work is not that political, but I had a show, I couldn't say the name of the art space to, you know, but I had a show in April, which was right after Ai Weiwei was taken away. So I did some paintings about Ai Weiwei and also pictures about the Hong Kong government. And then the art space didn't censor the Ai Weiwei thing, but they censored about the Hong Kong government painting. And they say it's not quite appropriate to have a show in Hong Kong and criticize about the Hong Kong government. And they want to take that painting away. And then, of course, I refused, and I told them if they cut off, because I have almost like 10 paintings in the show, I said, if you cut off just one painting, I will just withdraw from the show. And actually, the boss of the space just sent the image to a lot of different organization in Hong Kong and ask people. Actually, my friend told me, I didn't know he said it. He asked people, how do you feel as a Hong Kong person looking at a painting who have a sort of criticized about the Hong Kong government? And a lot of people say, we feel very pleasant if artists criticize about the Hong Kong government. We are very happy to see that. And they finally show the painting. And before I make some, I don't consider the painting to be political, but I use some material from the news from China to make some painting. It actually got shown in China without any difficulties because my work is with too many details and too many little words. I think they didn't have time to look through the painting, and just visually, it seems okay. It just got passed through all the time, so.
I normally like to play within safe constraints. I think I'm someone with very strong political thinking, but I don't always make it very explicit. I consider the recent work, the Shanghai Biennale piece, actually is very much in a very forceful way critiquing Cultural Revolution. But I felt I don't want to deal with those high-profile issues, and I don't want to reproduce the kind of human trauma that people normally would attach to Cultural Revolution. So actually, I did a lot of research on the postal history of Hong Kong, and I turned that disaster into numbers, into how much Hong Kong people have spent on money and also on purchasing material and to send back to mainland China via postage. It's supposed to be an irony about how the location of the position of Hong Kong in the entire story of the Cultural Revolution, and how actually it is us and our energy and our time and our money and our daily chores, especially by women in the domestic space, who sustained that spirit of those people, family members in mainland China. I was very, quite pleased that actually a lot of old people liked the work. Young people didn't know that I was critiquing anything about, and I used actually a lot of very explicit things, like we even have to send a can of sugar-coated fat meat, 2 pounds limit, to send it back because there was lacking in sugar, loss of penicillin. So these objects were all in the work. But because I like to stay to the language of everyday objects, it became very subdued and not loud. But anyone who actually saw it should know that it is a critique of Cultural Revolution. Yeah. The more recent censorship event I encountered was my participation, not only me, but a few Hong Kong artists' participation in the Nanjing Experimental Film Video Festival, which is a series, part of an Asian, alliance, the different festivals of the same nature in different countries and different cities. Everything was planned, the catalog was produced. Last minute, the whole Nanjing Festival was scrapped. There was not a document written down that tells you that it is going to be scrapped. It was only the organizers who got a series of phone calls of people who were participating, who withdrew from the event. So there was not a trace of evidence that you can put your finger on that this has been censored, but it was censored. There were efforts to find alternative places, like asking friends who are running a secondary school or primary school to host it. They said yes in the beginning, in the end they also withdrew. So there was, we didn't know what was going on, except that it is somehow related to Ai Weiwei. Ai Weiwei's work kind of presented to the authorities that all independent experimental works are subversive or rebellious or whatever adjective you want to use it. I haven't quite digested this yet, because even the curator couldn't get through to all the authorities. But I think this is something I want to think about, and what that means, and how are we going to show our works. Things like that.
Thank you. You don't have any.
I got nothing to say.
All right, I think we're reaching the end of our timeline, that there's any more pressing questions out there. So we'll conclude here, and I just wanted to ask everybody to thank our panelists for today.
Oh, hang on a sec. I also want to invite all of you guys to a preview of the installation that I've done for the Absolut Art Bureau. I believe there's going to be buses outside. We have an amazing opera singer who's going to be performing with the animatronic robot band at 5:30 and at 6. So it's right underneath the Fringe Club, so two floors below the Fringe Club. The access point is the first floor handicap accessible restroom. There's a door inside the bathroom that will lead you down into the cantina. So it would be wonderful if you guys would join us for a drink. You'll be the first people to see the installation. So thanks.
Yeah, and thanks again.